Welcome to Stockton University, and thanks for coming to hear about hate crimes and terrorism, danger at home and abroad, as a topic straight from the news. My name is Dan Douglas, and I'm the director of the Center for Public Policy, the William J. Hughes Center for Public Policy. Before we get started, please silence your cell phones and other such devices. But we do invite you to live tweet the presentation using the handles at UCenter and at Prof. Levin with the hashtag hate crimes, which we'll see as we start. When you came in, you were given an index card for you to write a question for Professor Levin. We will collect the cards immediately after his presentation and before we start the question and answer section. We also gave you an evaluation sheet that we ask you to complete at the end of the event. We also invite you to a casual reception after the event in the Board of Trustees meeting, Trustees room. And finally, it's my pleasure to introduce our newest president of Stockton, but who's been here for a while. Rumor is that they built the buildings around him, but nonetheless, it's my honor to introduce our president, Dr. Harvey Kesselman.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here tonight. I think you're in for a very informative talk. I'd like to, and then I'll go on to script because I really want to introduce, I was in Boston as part of the Campus Compact, 30th anniversary celebration of Campus Compact, the primary purpose of which is to ensure that students throughout the United States are focused on good citizenship. And I think tonight's talk and presentation will tangentially address that issue. And it's something that I want to reinforce not only today, but every single day, because it's critically important, particularly given the political climate in the United States right now, to ensure that all of our students, faculty, and staff participate in the election process. But welcome to Stockton. And welcome to an old friend, by the way, and colleague, Professor Brian Levin. First, permit me to thank the William Hughes Center for Public Policy for making this presentation possible tonight. Second, and this is, you know, something I really want to do, special thanks to Dr. David Carr, our former provost, and now, he's right there, raise your hand, David, former provost, and give him a round of applause, by the way. And now, professor of political science and the Hughes Center, director of research and policy analysis, for reestablishing contact with our special guests. This presentation, as I just mentioned, simply could not be timelier, when nearly every single day is stained with the blood from hate crimes. And now, unfortunately, even our mainstream political parties are mired in violence, masking as protest. All of us at Stockton watch and read the news with horror, and we fear that what happened at San Bernardino and in other places could very well happen here. These hateful events serve as a reminder of the need for Stockton's commitment to engagement and embracing diversity. We continue to learn that it is not enough, as I mentioned before, to simply be good students, which I'm sure every student in here is, but that it's also important, and even more important in many respects, to be good citizens, that are individuals who are aware, who are interested, who are involved, and who care about our university and our communities. So in order for our students to become good citizens, they need to hear from reasoned voices. I am absolutely proud to say that Brian Levin offered that reasoned voice while serving as a faculty member in our criminal justice program, where he taught, and I remember him well from then, from 1996 to 1999. Prior to entering the academy, Brian worked for the Southern Poverty Law Center's Klan Watch Militia Task Force. He was a corporate litigator and a New York City police officer in Harlem and Washington Heights during the 1980s. Since then, he has taught at California State University, San Bernardino, where he is the founding director of the Center for the Study of Hate and Extremism. Brian has written various Supreme Court Friend of the Court briefs. He is the author, co-author, and editor of many books, scholarly articles, training manuals, and studies on extremism and hate crimes. His body of work has yielded prestigious awards and has been referenced in numerous social science journals and major law reviews. Brian is a court-certified expert in both the United States and the United Kingdom and has provided testimony before both houses of Congress. He has consulted for the FBI and the Department of Homeland Security and other federal agencies, as well as state governments, universities, and civil rights groups. You can view Brian on every news outlet, on TV and on the web. He is the go-to expert on hate crimes. He recently attended a KKK rally to do research and found himself in the middle of the melee. So he brings an academic perspective and a, quote, ripped from the headlines freshness to his work. Even a casual observer of the news would be hard-pressed to miss Brian. He has appeared on every American broadcast and cable news network, including shows like 60 Minutes, Dateline NBC, The Today Show, Good Morning America, The O'Reilly Factor, Anderson Cooper 360, and Hardball, to mention a few. In addition to appearing in every major American newspaper, news magazine, and wire service, Brian has appeared in international news on six continents and has lectured around the world. Brian's take on the national scene appears regularly on the Huffington Post. He has also presented for TEDx. Members of the Stockton community, we are so fortunate to have Brian return home to share with us his expertise and experience. Please join me in welcoming back Professor Brian Levin.
Thank you, you're such a mensch.
This wasn't my situation. We're also talking to Anaheim police about it this hour. Let's show you some video of what happened. This is over the weekend on Saturday at Pearson Park here in Anaheim.
It had been publicized that the KKK was going to hold a demonstration at that park on Saturday, but when they got there, they were met by more than two dozen counter-protesters, and then things quickly got violent. We're told by some of the witnesses and police almost immediately when those KKK members got out of their car, things turned violent. Apparently, the KKK members were attacked. That's when you see all this taking place. But right in the middle of all of this, this happened. Let's show you a second piece of video with some images in it. You're going to see some pictures of a Cal State San Bernardino professor putting himself between the counter-protesters and the KKK members who were being attacked. He was actually trying to protect these KKK members, even though he cannot stand their views. He is actually Jewish, and he actually said to one of the KKK members as he was protecting him, or sometime after he was protecting him, "How does it feel to have your life possibly saved by a Jewish guy?"
They brought up White Lives Matter. Why did you feel their lives mattered as much as you disagree with what they represent?
My mother raised me right. My mother raised me right, and my faith says that all people have divinity, and everyone has the ability to change. And I would hope, but I wouldn't put any money on it, that this Klansman would change his ways. I've seen it. I've seen hardened bigots change their ways. I've had them address my classes. But in any event, my immediate response was not a philosophical one. I did not want anyone critically injured in the street or worse.
Now, you should be seeing a picture right now of a man in a blue shirt. That is a counter-protester police are still looking for. If you know who he is, you can contact Anaheim police. In all, 12 people were initially arrested. However, five of those people were the KKK members. The KKK members were later released because it was determined by police that they were acting in self-defense. When we asked police about that, they said actually one of the protesters, or at least one of the protesters, used a knife and stabbed some of the counter-protesters during this event. When asked what constitutes self-defense in a situation like that, here's what police had to say.
You can use a weapon to defend yourself. Obviously, what will be looked at is the reasonableness of that. Was it reasonable under the circumstances? That's one of the things that the district attorney's office will look at as well. However, we had clear and convincing evidence from the videos that the KKK members were trying to flee on foot. Three had fled in a vehicle. Three more were trying to remove themselves from the situation, and they were actually chased down by these people and physically attacked. At that point, they obviously have the right to self-defense.
Now, in response to all these incidents over the weekend, there's actually going to be a peace rally tonight. We're told that Anaheim's chief of police will actually participate in that, and we should be there as well to bring you that one. For now, reporting live in Anaheim, I'm Chip Yost, KTLA 5 News.
Thank you so much. With that kind of introduction, I should keep my statements very short. But thank you so much. First, let me get some leisure domain issues out of the way. President Kesselman, you are living proof that sometimes nice guys finish first. Is that true? Gosh. I could talk for 45 minutes about what a mensch he is, but he wouldn't like that. I know him. But I will say a couple of things, though, if you'd indulge me. The one thing that I can tell you about Dr. Kesselman, a beautiful campus, wonderful architecture, all that is very nice. Believe me, it is. I'm thrilled to be here. But I'm gonna see how big I made it here, because I'm gonna use a first name for a president. I've never done that, but bear with me. But with Harvey, students always, always, always came first, always. We don't live in a world now where the baseball players stay with the same team for their career. Let me see if my memory serves me correct. I think you were Dean of Student Affairs when I was here. Is that it? Yeah. The students were his life. And to see someone who I have such great affection for become now the president of the institution that launched my academic career has such a special meaning. You get to a point in your career where you can say exactly what the heck you think. And one of the nicest things is when it comes from the heart and meaningful. Thank you so much. And hold on, we're not done. And I want you to give my warmest regards to the First Lady, Lynn, of Stockton University. It is a rare achievement that we have someone who is a Mayflower student now head up the institution that opened up his academic life. What a privilege it is to be here with you. It is, just on a personal level, what a wonderful privilege. Similarly, there's just a couple other people I'm going to thank. I'm sorry, but it's a very meaningful thing for me to come back to the place that launched my academic career. So just indulge me this for a minute, and then we'll talk all about hate and horrible things. David Carr, who's the former provost, was dean when I came here. You can use a position like that to intimidate someone or to make up for something you're lacking, or you can be so comfortable in your brilliance that your job is to make other people shine. David Carr, you have been such a phenomenal mentor for me. I don't think I would have achieved half of what I did if I didn't have your kindness and your gentle guidance and the ability to, frankly, in fact, the next lecture is going to be, what the heck are university bureaucracy is about. If someone can explain that, that'll answer black holes and the theory of relativity and everything else. But just what a wonderful mentor you were for me. I would be remiss if I didn't take a lot more time than I'm going to thank you. But you are such a special scholar and such a special person. And sometimes you lead by letting other people shine. That's a leader. Don't forget that in today's world. Dan Douglas, head of the William J. Hughes Center, thank you so much for making all this happen. There's someone who makes all the little things occur, and he did on this trip. And lastly, Chief Parker, thank you for having law enforcement here tonight. It makes it a much more comfortable environment. Just a short note, because of the terrible, terrible terrorist attack that my community experienced, I had the privilege of giving the first Yoti talk. If you thought that the ospreys were the only interesting mascot, we have the coyotes. And I went to my talk a few weeks ago. We had the inaugural 50th Yoti talk. It was kind of like a TED talk. And a fellow comes in and he said, "I had the place sniff for you." And I didn't know what the heck he was talking about. And I saw that he was the trainer for law enforcement. They had a dog sniff the place. So I was like, well, it's an interesting world we live in, ancient Chinese said. But first of all, thank you so much. It is such a privilege to come back to the place that not only launched my career academically, but made me feel welcome and that I made the right choice. This was the hardest job that I ever left because this was the one that I loved that I left. Thank you. Richard Stockton, like me, was a lawyer and an educator, and like my father, he was a POW. His legacy also, as the signer of the Declaration of Independence, I think is a perfect segue to what we're experiencing today. We have to balance a variety of things relating to personal liberty, but also what rights we give up to live in a civilized society. What I'm going to talk to you about are those who stand in the way of that. And if I can figure out how to use this clicker, my kids don't trust me with the remote. I always worry that I'm going to cause a blackout in some distant city. That's me, and that's the photograph that I don't think I'll live down. I got a note from somebody. You get a variety of notes when things get publicized. Someone said that I should be excommunicated from my faith for saving the Klansmen. Although I did check with my rabbi, and the rabbi said that if you save a life, even that of a schmuck, it's a good deed, it's a mitzvah. So here are some issues we're gonna talk about if I can get away from the Klan rally, which I apparently will never live down. But I got another note that said, "Dear Professor Levin, thank you, I think you did the right thing. Please don't make this a regular habit." Let's look at some trends and issues that are going on now in the world of hate and terrorism. First thing that I'm going to start off with is there are definitional and data collection issues. So you're going to see a lot of data tonight. Remember, there's a lot of limitations with this data, but because of the short amount of time that I have to speak, luckily for you, we won't go into it. But just remember, the data is always going to have limitations on it. What else do we know? Well, reported hate crimes are low and declining, according to the official reports, but the true numbers are higher. And you'll see a vast gap between reported hate crimes and those that aren't. Extremist groups. Now, this is really interesting. Extremist groups, particularly domestically, are morphing to the internet to spread their message. Obviously, so are foreign groups as well. But the risks and consequences relate not only to mass destruction, but also, aside from violence, privacy, free speech, and of course, bigotry, backlash. Terror, we have a two-part issue. One are lone wolves, both domestically and those that are inspired from international sources. The international terrorist groups, and I want you to really listen to this one. What happened to my community not only could happen anywhere, but it's going to happen again. Their are folks out there whose main purpose is being at war with everyone but them. And that includes, by the way, moderate Muslims. It includes Westerners. One thing I want to tell you, if you look at who assassinated Anwar Sadat, who assassinated Gandhi, and who assassinated Yitzhak Rabin, were all co-religionists. The fanatics go after their own first. One of the things that just came out today, though, London is preparing for 10 simultaneous attacks at once. This is the new place we're living in. I don't want to say that we were lucky in San Bernardino. We were not. But by the same token, I can tell you that groups like ISIS want to have much more spectacular attacks, but they're also happy to have amateurs who are inspired by them to commit mass acts of violence. What are some things that Congress just said this month? I try to get all the up-to-date information for you. March 16th, they're warning of spectacular attacks, they're warning of Iranian proxies, Al-Qaeda in the Iranian Peninsula, and 40 ISIS European refugees that have just been identified. What do we have here domestically? Oy, it wasn't enough that we don't have stuff from elsewhere. What do we have? We have an angry electorate. You'll see that in some of the data. We have attacks and arrests that are presaging a rise of political violence. We are now seeing members of candidates' families experiencing terroristic threats. We're seeing violence at rallies. In the words of one of the less erudite candidates, not good. What are some other issues we have? Distrust and political dislocation, nationalism, religious tensions, inequality. The United States has 5% of the population, yet incarcerates 25% of the world's incarcerated individuals. Demographic changes and economic shifts. Now they put them all to sleep, let's go to something else. Anti-Islam prejudice, 43% of Americans say they have some type of prejudice against our Muslim neighbors and citizens. We have a major candidate, and it's not just him. I am sorry to say that the governor of this state said that he would not accept refugees younger than 5. If this is what our leadership is saying, what can we expect rank and file citizens to emulate or imitate? It's always good, though, to start with, how the heck did we get here? Haters and extremists are made, not born. Prejudice and hate are attitudes, and I have John White here who will explain the psychology to me, because I only took that undergrad. You have the affective, the cognitive, and the cognitive. Or for folks like me, the emotional, the belief system, and the behavioral. Prejudice is distinguished by inflexibility with regard to new info. Most of our hate offenders act on negative stereotypes, but not deeply held ones. Here's what I think is problematic about what's going on here domestically. We have an electorate that includes very angry folks. The percentage of people that had trust in the federal government in the year I was born, 1987, 64. 77%. You know what it is now? 19%. So the institutions that hold us together, the processes, are not trusted. So what do we have? On top of that, we have leaders that are promoting division between groups, using factually incorrect data, and encouraging violence. Not good. Let's look at how this all happens from a practical execution standpoint. Prejudice occurs across a pyramid, a spectrum, starting from non-criminal all the way up to genocide and war crimes. When we have leaders that give the imprimatur that violence is acceptable, or label certain groups of people as being dangerous out of anecdotal examples, that creates a mix that galvanizes and legitimizes the very type of violent activity that we are trying to tamp down. Let's look at what a hate crime is. Basically, a hate crime is a criminal offense that's motivated in whole or significant part by the actual or perceived status of somebody else. So you could attack someone because you think they're from one group, but they're from another group. We see this a lot with anti-Sikh attacks from people who think they're Muslim. Hate Crime Statistics Act was signed by President George Bush the Elder in April of 1990. In Wisconsin versus Mitchell, the United States Supreme Court upheld hate crime laws unanimously. I had the privilege of writing a couple of briefs in that case, and sometimes I end up on the winning side. But like some of the Philly fans in the audience, I understand your pain. 45 states in the federal government, that didn't go well, Harvey. That did not go well. 45 states in the federal government have hate crime laws. There are 5 states that don't. The states, though, vary as to what groups are covered. So only 30 some odd, for instance, low 30s, cover sexual orientation or gender, for instance. Well, let's look at the types of people who are doing these things. Criminal justice data and car sale receipts always have asterisks, by the way. Read the fine print. The first type are thrill-seeking. They're out for excitement. The next is defensive. They're protecting turf, for instance, and retaliatory, responding to threats or what they think is disrespect. Mission offenders are the hardcore folks, ISIS, JDL, members of hardcore hate groups like the Klan or skinheads. Those are the hardcore folks. Notice they contribute a very small number of the overall hate crimes, most of which are not terribly violent. But they're responsible, the mission folks, 35 to 40% of the bias homicides. Interestingly enough, in the month after the Paris attacks, we had a 2.94 times the number of anti-Muslim hate crimes. Not talking about incidents, not talking about passive things or disrespectful, I'm talking about criminal acts in the month after the Paris attacks. Then they appeared to recede after about 6 or 7 weeks. The FBI reported 5,479 hate crimes in 2014. This is a massive undercount. We don't have the time to go into the lack of reporting, how some states like Mississippi report from 0 to 4 every year, yet they have the highest percentage of African Americans in the country. I met with Attorney General Eric Holder and spoke with to him about this some years ago. I also, by the way, took the opportunity to say, you're a Yankee fan and your boss is a White Sox fan. How does that work? We don't have time for that. But this is the breakdown, though, and I think this is valuable, though, even though the numbers are a massive undercount. This is a breakdown of what we've seen. This is the latest data the FBI has. It lags a little over a year. New Jersey, race continues to be the top category, and the overwhelming majority African American. Religion, right up there. New Jersey has among the highest population of Jews, so that's where you're getting that number as well. What we're seeing in any given year, about 58 to 60 some odd percent of the religious hate crimes against Jews, then the next number are Muslims. Jews are about a little under 2% of the population. Muslims, depending, and there's no census for it, about 1% of the population. And in the last year, there were, I believe there were about 160 anti-Muslim hate crimes officially reported to police, but the numbers are far higher And all you have to do is go out into the community and ask. This shows you, though, a little different thing. The FBI counts crimes that are reported to police. The Bureau of Justice Statistics does household victimization surveys. And this shows their estimates. Look at this. So the FBI says in 2014, there are about 5,479 hate crimes. And that is a decline from about 10 to 11,000 in prior years. But look at what we're seeing from the Bureau of Justice Statistics, which actually surveys respondents in their homes. Almost 300,000 any given year. 2011, they had some data mechanical changes that affected that. But it's been fairly consistent. If we rely on that, we can see that hate crimes are about 1% of the total victimizations. We don't have the time, unfortunately. If we were to take out the violent hate crimes out of that, they actually are about 3 to 4% of all violent victimizations in the United States. 35 days before San Bernardino was hit by the worst terrorist attack since 9/11 in the United States, I told Congress that we face multiple severe risk factors and a diverse set of emerging contemporary actors. I also said that Salafist jihadists such as ISIS and Al-Qaeda represent the most prominent, but not the only threat. It is very important, though, it is very important to make sure that we put this in context. We are talking about a sliver of the Muslim community in the United States. Do not listen to demagogues who try to formulate policy based on fear. You know, there's a saying, a fool with a plan is better than a genius with none. I would add an asterisk, of course, and say, except for a fool with a really bad plan. And these are some observations I had prior to some of the attacks. After Paris, I talked about this is a harbinger of the future. I said we're vulnerable in Southern California, where we ended up getting hit. I talked about in France, before the latest Paris attacks, there are so many potential terrorists being tracked, it's hard to track them all. Before San Bernardino, I even said, of course, ISIS would do anything, including using women, which they did. 83% of Americans, shortly before the San Bernardino attack, believed that we'd have an attack like that on our soil. And I said on the front page of the Huffington Post, I echoed those concerns. Just 5 days later, our backyard was hit. A problem that we have with both hate crime and terrorism is, what is it? Well, the FBI's definition talks about the use of force or threat to intimidate or coerce a government or a subgroup of the population for social or political objectives. Let's look at the types of folks who are doing these acts of symbolic violence. First type is the ideologically motivated. They're either religious, political, or a hybrid. Then we have the psychologically dangerous, cognitively impaired, or the sociopath. And because my friend who is a psychologist, John, is here tonight, I looked up cognitive. That's how you spell it. I'm a criminologist. I don't know these highfalutin terms. Or sociopath. Then there's personal benefit or revenge. Now, a lot of these can be mixed and matched, except for the cognitively impaired or the sociopath. Sociopath knows what they're doing. They just don't care. How do these folks fall in organizationally? Well, we have lone offenders, we see them. We have duos. There's usually a leader and a follower. The interesting thing about the San Bernardino attack is it goes back and forth. Who led it? Usually in a duo, we have some actor who dominates a lesser party in that. We have an autonomous cell, as well as a commanded cell and a large group. With regard to ISIS and similar groups, they are happy to inspire lone offenders or duos, inspire without necessarily a direct orchestration of the event. And they publish magazines Inspire magazine by Al-Qaeda, or Dabiq magazine by ISIS. But what I'm telling you, and I think this is important for where we're going, we have a two-pronged threat, at least a two-pronged threat, with regard to international. And that is not only inspiring loners and duos, but also having a commanded cell. Europe is different. Geographically, it's closer, and you can drive or get through by land from the Middle East into the European heartland. What else? Just bigger populations for folks to try to radicalize people. If we look at our era of super terrorism, one of the things that I want to point out, if you look at the top four, they're all within the last 30 years or so. Unfortunately, with terrorism, it tends to inspire folks to try and outdo the last malefactor. Compare that to some of the earlier attacks, and you'll see that we're in a new era. The FBI, although I don't think they officially released this, but it's been like everything else, it's been leaked all over the internet, except they're not suing for $115 million. Their domestic threat assessment looks at white supremacists, extremists, black separatists, anti-government militias, abortion extremists. We're talking about violent people, not people of goodwill who oppose abortion. Violent animal extremists, environmental extremists, sovereign citizen nationalists, and anarchists. This is the stew of domestic-centered folks. Now, the FBI does a weird thing. They don't include religious extremists who may have been born and bred here if they're influenced by foreign entities like ISIS. Let's take a look, though, at some of the interesting data that we have. Since 9/11, far-right extremists have actually killed more people in the United States. Many of them, most of them, are lone wolves. And additionally, they're active shooters. Not that we haven't had those folks who want to do bombings. If we look at Salafist jihadists, slightly less killed, but the injuries are more. So for instance, the Fort Hood shooting by Nidal Hassan not only killed about 13 people, but it injured dozens more. The Boston Marathon bombing killed about 3 people. There's also an officer that was killed in a firefight, an MIT police officer. But over 260 people were injured because they used pressure cooker bombs. That's Wade Page, who played in a hate rock band, murdered almost a half a dozen people at a Sikh temple in Wisconsin. And that's the second latest issue of Dabiq magazine. This is just from like the last week or two with respect to ISIS. These are the headlines. I'm not gonna read them all, but you get the idea. We are going to be hit again. We do not need a climate that takes the very moderates that we so desperately need in the fight against extremism and marginalizing, degrading, and insulting them. It's not only immoral, it's incredibly bad national security public policy. This is the latest Homeland Security Committee. This is from the majority side, so that's the Republican side. But what you can't see in the bottom, it says 31% of these incidents are just in the last year. And they show 83 total ISIS-linked arrests in the US. We have about 900 investigations going on in all 50 states. This is the head of ISIS. I don't know if U of Baghdad is going to use him in their promotional materials. They're the newest and they're in some ways the most dangerous. Foreign fighters, 6,900 hold Western passports. Most of those, very few of them are from the United States. But here's the thing. Don't think that the geography and the fact that we have far, far fewer fighters means that they don't want to hit us. along with England, the Pope and the Vatican, the United States, is among their most widely held enemies in their literature. And they have the most sophisticated web presence we've ever seen with a terrorist entity. And they have $1 billion in resources, and they control an area the size of South Carolina, which makes it basically a magnet for people to come in and get trained. We have had some victories. We just had a defector come out just in the last week, and a huge cache of information about who they're recruiting, the actual identities of folks. I think about 22,000. So it's a cat and mouse battle that's going on. Domestically, my old employer, Southern Poverty Law Center, found a 14% increase in hate groups last year. This is after several years of decline. Look at the difference in numbers. The Klan more than doubled. This is in Klan chapters. I don't think, though, that it means that the number of Klansmen and women in the United States has doubled. I think we're seeing the hate world get more diffuse. But a lot of that increase came from the massacre in South Carolina at Mother Emanuel Church and the resulting debate with respect to the Confederate flag. However, we're probably talking about somewhere between 4,500 and 6,500 Klan members nationwide. So, for instance, probably have more rotary phones in the United States than Klan members. And they're probably smarter. Look at New Jersey. 40 hate groups ranks the state fifth. 14 chapters of the 40, 14 of the 40 are AC skins. And we have them in Galloway, Absecon, Egg Harbor, and Atlantic City. So, Chief Parker, thanks again. Anti-government groups. Now, some of these, now this is again from another group, this is from the Southern Poverty Law Center, not my own data. These groups, many of them are perfectly legal. But just gives you an idea. Anti-government is mainstream. The hatred for President Obama, our first African-American president, is extremely disturbing. Conspiracy theories and racist demagoguery have washed over into mainstream politics, where millions of Americans who are not members of hate groups, for instance, upwards of 40% of Republican voters state that they believe President Obama is a Muslim. And I don't think they think highly of our Muslim friends and neighbors. Let's look at what we've seen. And we have a wonderful polling institute here at Stockton, so this is really interesting. One of the reasons I don't include a lot of Democratic figures is just because the exit polling done by Edison Associates for the National Polling Group did not ask them the same questions. But I want you to get an idea. Look at this percentage in Virginia, South Carolina, and Ohio of those favoring a ban on Muslims coming to the United States. Or deport most working undocumented people. Look at the number with respect to anger or dissatisfaction at the government. By the way, interestingly, in a CNN poll from December, 90% of Republican voters nationally said that they were angry or dissatisfied at the government. And 97% of those who supported Donald Trump thought so. So US voters angry at the federal government, 42% of Republicans say they're angry, 11% of Democrats. Again, public trust, 1964, 77%. Today, 19% trust the federal government. One of the things that we're seeing is not only a lack of trust, but the evolution of fear. And when that gets combined, it creates a combustible environment that can be determined by a variety of things, including, for instance, if we have an event such as a terrorist attack, but also if we have leadership that gives the imprimatur of acceptability to division and violence. It is a combustible mix, and I think it's something we all should be aware of. I want to just leave with a couple of thoughts, and then I'll take questions or do what, I guess we're going to have a little sit down. Martin Luther King said, the function of education is to teach one to think intensively and to think critically. Intelligence plus character, that is the true goal of education. One of the things that I think we need to do as a progressive community is to have not only diversity of people, but diversity of ideas. If we have this many angry people on certain sides of the political spectrum, I think it's incumbent upon us to have a dialogue. And one of the things I think is incumbent is that we open up universities more to conservative people of goodwill, even when we disagree with things. Obviously, when they're not of goodwill, that's a different story. But I think this notion that we have on many college campuses to prevent people who have served admirably in government or business or academia and to censor their presence is a woefully, woefully egregious idea. Anger and intolerance are the enemies of correct understanding, Mahatma Gandhi said. And I think he's right. I am not saying, by the way, that the fact that conservative viewpoints have been censored on college campuses is a justification of the kind of horrendous violence, bigotry, and division that we're seeing in this process we're going through now. However, I think action starts with everyone. And I think we must open up academia to not only diversity of people, but diversity of viewpoints, which is sorely lacking. The same could be said, by the way, for much of talk radio. Let me just close with one of my favorite quotes. And I think it fits nicely with what we need in this political season, as opposed to what we're consuming. On April 4th, 1968, Martin Luther King was assassinated in Memphis, Tennessee. Rioting broke out across the United States, but one city was spared, and that was Indianapolis, Indiana. Senator Robert F. Kennedy, who himself was to be assassinated just about 2 months later in Los Angeles, said the following, and I'd like to just indulge just a brief excerpt of what he said in a place that experienced nothing but peace that night. Senator Kennedy, who was running for president in a very difficult electoral challenge, said, "What we need in the United States is not division. What we need in the United States is not hatred. What we need in the United States is not violence and lawlessness, but is love and wisdom and compassion towards one another and a feeling of justice toward those who still suffer within our country, whether they be black or whether they be white. It is not the end of violence. It is not the end of lawlessness. And it's not the end of disorder. But the vast majority of white people and the vast majority of black people in this country want to live together, want to improve the quality of our life, and want justice for all human beings that abide in our land. Let us dedicate ourselves to what the Greeks wrote so many years ago, to tame the savageness of man and make gentle the life of this world. Let us dedicate ourselves to that and say a prayer for our country and for our people. Thank you very much."
Thank you very much. Over there, I'll get you. Thank you, Brian, for a terrific presentation. We now have an opportunity for some questions and answers, and Brian will be joined by Sharon Shulman, who will facilitate the questions. If you have questions, you were given a card when you came in. Please pass them to the side, and there'll be people picking up the cards so that we can have that discussion. So we ask our panelists to have a seat, and we'll get started in a few minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, and thank you, Professor Levin, for being here tonight and giving us some of the facts that are behind this. Here's our first question. What are foreign governments doing that we should be imitating?
I think we could look at Canada. Not saying that they don't have issues. I just had the privilege of meeting with the Canadian consulate in Southern California. They're a very smart bunch because they love Canada, but they get the sunshine too. When Syrian refugees came to Canada, Prime Minister Trudeau greeted them. We can't formulate a cogent and effective response to a real threat, by the way. And as I testified before Congress, while over the last 15 years, out of the 784,000 refugees that came to the United States, five have been accused or convicted of being involved in terrorism. Unfortunately, one of the things I can tell you, whether it's predicting earthquakes, the weather, baseball, or politics, retrospective data has extreme limitations. There is a threat that comes from groups like ISIS wanting to infiltrate refugees. That threat is much greater with respect to Europe than it is here. It is not a non-existent threat. That being said, what is our country about? I wrote a 2,700 word piece for the Huffington Post. I do believe that groups like ISIS would like to infiltrate the refugee population. However, it's a suboptimal choice for them. They have far better choices available to them. If they were to do this, though, I think it would be to create division here. And I want to be clear, because this is important. I am also afraid of anti-Muslim extremism like what we saw in Scandinavia. One of the things that, for those of us in the terrorism monitoring world today, is yes, in our constellation of evil terrorist stars that are out there, there are some that shine their evil threat a little more. And I do think entities like ISIS and AQAP do. But they're not the only stars in that evil constellation. Anti-government extremists, when you have 43% of the American population saying that admittedly, that they're prejudiced against Muslims, and 9% saying that they're hardcore prejudiced. Compare that, for instance, with respect to Jews. And this is important. There's data, and then there's context. The Jewish population, about 15 to 18% have some anti-Semitic viewpoints. And the number of attacks, hate crime attacks against Jews, is actually higher than with respect to Muslims. However, when you look at the hate crime that takes place, what I think we're seeing is that there's something different. The percentage of people who say they would vote for a Jewish person for president is now higher than those who would say they'd vote for a Mormon or even a Catholic. So we have 9% of the population with hardcore hatred, admittedly. And you put into that mix fear and the fact that we will be hit again, and we have
political leaders that are giving countenance and comfort to those who are trying to stoke this fear. So I think one of the things that we have to do is obviously respond to national security. I think if there's, and if I, we're nonpartisan, if there's a mistake that President Obama, who I have great affection for, if there's a mistake that he made, is I think he was dismissive about the threat when he called ISIS a JV team, and when he accurately said, that they were territorially contained. That was like when Robert Bork said there was no right to privacy in the Constitution. You know, I got a piece of advice about marriage. You could be right or you could be married. President Obama was correct, they were territorially contained. I think what we need to do is have a balance. I think we have to set a tone that rejects bigotry, because once we have bigotry as part of the public policy discussion, it poisons it. We know that folks are not coming from a place of goodwill. The other thing that I would say is that we have to maintain good relations with the overwhelming proportion of the Muslim American community who is just as horrified at this action as others. And remember, the greatest number of people that are killed by these fanatics are co-religionists. So I think what we should do, like Canada, is that we should understand that there is a threat. There really is, and we are going to get hit again. I don't know where it is. It could be anywhere. ISIS is saying, don't just attack symbolic targets, attack anywhere you can. So they're looking for both the spectacular and the mundane. But America means something. And when we see a three-year-old child that washes up on a Turkish shore, what we have to do is approach this and say, we want to take in some refugees. We might have to make some hard decisions about combat age males, for instance. But when we have folks that are saying that Muslims should be socially excluded in this country from political, social, and civic life, the terrorists have already won when that happens.
Thank you. I think you may be interrupting a few people's sleep tonight with some of the comments you're making here. Obviously, I can't possibly get you to answer all these questions.
I'll try and be quicker.
Okay, that's okay. I still don't think you can do all these questions. How much does social media have to do with the lack of faith in our government?
That's a great question. I did a rather uninspiring TED talk, but only because of the delivery, not the substance. And one of the things that research has shown is we would think that in an era where we have access to information, that we would seek out better information, but we're not. We've created an echo chamber where people are self-selecting out to those who confirm their anger, fears, and here's the thing that I think is very interesting with respect to social media, conspiracy theories. And we're seeing that across a spectrum. So for instance, the percentage of people who believe that President Obama wasn't born in the United States are tens of millions of people. Or that the government is poisoning people through entrails in the sky. Or that Ted Cruz was a member of a 90s rock band. That might be true. The research has shown that one would think that we would be more engaged with different ideas, but what's actually happening for many people is they're confirming their own hatred, fears, and conspiracy theories. And the internet has been a boon to extremists. Let me just give you an example of something just in the mainstream. We had a major political candidate retweet a set of statistics on black on white crime that was totally false and came from a white supremacist website.
Thank you. On to the next question then. You noted that hatred is a learned behavior. Do you think we can use our education system to deprogram this learned behavior through diversity and civic education?
Yes, but I think we have to be careful of something. The government should not be in the business of setting up an orthodoxy of acceptable ideas. That's not the role. The role of education should be to treat people with respect and dignity and to learn to critically think. Here's what I worry about. I worry about the fact that we are sanitizing things to such a point that we can't look at different entities critically, whether it's a religious group of any kind, political parties, governing leaders. I would much prefer that we, and this is what I try to do when I teach, to engage people from different perspectives and to learn how to think as opposed to what to think. And that is why it is my belief and my practice. I didn't certainly try to save a Klansman on First Amendment grounds, but I think it reflects something that, particularly in academia, in higher education, as well as talk radio, by the way, that we are not giving countenance, challenge, and respect to ideas that might be different from ours. You're entitled to your own opinions. You're not entitled to your own facts.
Thank you. This is a two-part question. Do hate crime statistics go up every time something happens, like in Paris? And if so, why do you think people are not reporting more hate crimes?
Great question. Generally, yes. And we've seen this trend after the Rodney King verdict in 1992. We had record numbers of hate crimes reported by just about every jurisdiction in the United States that at that time was keeping data. And one of the things that I put into my Stanford Law and Policy article, as well as the Supreme Court briefs, showed that spike. And that spike generally comes down. We saw hate crimes increase by about 1,300% after 9/11. In Los Angeles County, for instance, in the month after the Paris, in the 2 months, November, December, they did their data a little different. There were 11 reported hate crimes in that 2 month period, anti-Muslim hate crimes, compared to one the previous year. So we see a spike, and then we see kind of a quiescent period. Although after 9/11, we saw the numbers go back down, but not to the extent that they were before. There were 28 anti-Muslim hate crimes in 2000. That went up to 488 in 2001, with most in the last quarter of that year, obviously. And then we've been in a range of about 100 to 160 since then. So we haven't gone back down. But that being said, there's a lot of mistrust in many of the communities that are most damaged by hate crimes. By the way, the most commonly murdered folks in hate attacks are homeless people. And they feel they have nowhere to go. That is one of the new trends that we've seen over the last 15 years, anti-homeless bias homicides. So why there are cultural barriers, linguistic barriers, a feeling that people won't do anything. I had a student in my class who said after 9/11 she was beaten and never reported it. So there's cultural, linguistic, it's a personal nature, and in some cultures, being a victim of a crime is considered something to be shamed about. We have to reach out to communities, and we have to understand that the overwhelming majority of people in so many of these communities are being victimized. I do think that there's something important, though. I don't think here that we're seeing the levels of hate crimes we could. I think it's possible for it to explode even more. Here's what I think we're seeing. We try to label the most headline-oriented thing, and we try to track the hate crimes. And I think there's far more, for instance, anti-Muslim hate crimes by a long shot than what we're seeing reported. However, what I think, I don't want to say it's more disturbing because I don't want to degrade someone's suffering, but what I think is more prominent is the social, civic, and communal exclusion of Muslims from American life by many of our citizens, and even worse yet, by our political leaders. So when President Obama goes to a mosque and speaks of the divinity of our nation, where President Washington said, we give to bigotry no sanction and to prejudice no existence, in his letter to the Toro Synagogue in the 1790s. Or where Thomas Jefferson, this is interesting, and I think it'll fit well here at Stockton. On his epitaph, wanted three things. On his grave marker, wanted three things. Not President of the United States, founder of the University of Virginia, signer of the Declaration of Independence, and author of the Virginia Statute of Religious Freedom. And indeed, his enemies labeled him a Muslim to try and degrade him in the eye of the public. It is a terrible thing that this country stood for religious tolerance has now changed. And that is not only going to affect us with regard to national security in a negative way, it's going to affect American exceptionalism and our stature in the world. It is a terrible thing that is going on now. And I'll tell you something. When I go and speak somewhere about anti-Muslim prejudice, I get more hate mail than from anything I've done in my entire career. And I'm not Muslim.
Thank you. That leads to a couple of questions here that relate to refugees and the acceptance of refugees. And what do you think is the best way to separate infiltrators from legitimate refugees?
FBI Director Comey, a week before I testified before Congress, made a very important point. And that is, in some places, like Iraq, for instance, we had significant records because we had a military presence there for some time. Al-Baghdadi, by the way, was released from a prison. We know all about him, the head of ISIS. In Syria, there's a significant issue where we don't know the backgrounds of many refugees. The fact of the matter is we had very few, five, out of the 784,000 that came prior to the ascension of ISIS. I'm more of a process-oriented person. And what I'm saying is, I don't think there's a foolproof mechanism. But the visa waiver program is not a foolproof mechanism either. Or the fact that people who are on terrorist watch lists can buy assault weapons in the United States. So I think this has been politicized. That being said, I think certainly, with respect to children, we have to open our gates. To some degree, even if it's a small number, if we don't, it changes who we are. And do you want to be the person when your grandchild is sitting on your lap, says, what the heck did you do during that time when these innocent children were being washed ashore, trying to just escape the hell on earth that exists in Syria and Iraq? That being said, just this month, Turkey and the EU signed an agreement to try and keep folks more in region. I am more someone who looks at process and intent, knowing that if we deliberate and have a process for addressing the problem, including the legitimate question, and this is, if I fault President Obama on one thing, I am not someone who likes to degrade him. I think he has been a beacon of tolerance to the world. If you read his speech with respect to the righteous and the Holocaust just from a month or so ago, when people say he's divisive, what planet are you on, people? Go read his rhetoric. That being said, he did not address the legitimate fears of the American public about what was going on. And when the director of the FBI, who's a person of goodwill as well, says that we can't vet some of these people, and just saying, trust me, we have a process that lasts a certain amount of time, ended up having it become politically dead. I think we have to go in with, we want to help refugees. How can we do it? We might not be able to take as many as we otherwise would like. But to say we're not going to do it, or to have major candidates saying ban Muslims. What if we said ban Presbyterians or ban Jews or ban Buddhists? What kind of response would we get? This is a terrible affront, not only to morality, but to the American exceptionalism which helped found us on religious tolerance. We've already losing when we're responding to that fear. That being said, we must have some kind of plan that is understandable to the American public, and that has not been done.
Sharon, can I ask you to pick the last question and wrap up the evening?
The last question, okay.
I must have done a doozy on that last one, huh? Yeah.
No, that was a good one, and I have a lot of good questions, but this one is just the perfect one to end now that we've done this, and you've just talked about some of the presidential campaigns. And,
Ringo.
Okay, that's what I want to know. What's your prediction? Ringo, huh?
No, with regards to the presidential election?
What is your prediction in this year's presidential campaign?
Well, I will give you the answer that you don't like, and that is I run a nonpartisan center, and it is very important for someone who reaches out to conservative people of goodwill as well as progressives not to make my center partisan or to be engaged in predictions. What I can say is at a place we have polling, looking at the polling, it's very interesting. If you look at the people who are most fearful, they are voting more conservatively. However, there seems to be an upper limit. I will not make predictions, but I will tell you this. Right now, the polls indicate that Democratic candidates are generally outpolling Republicans. Not all. But I would say two things. One, we're early in the season. Number two, candidates can pivot. And if a candidate wants to appeal to a more broad electorate, they oftentimes, once they get through the primary season, soften their tone. There are two things that I think are going to be important to look at. What's going to happen with regard to disaffection and violence at political events? Right. Also, what's going to happen with respect to the candidates and the leadership they are providing? Are they going to be able to expand their base on either side? And the other thing I'm going to say, the wild card. If there's a terrorist attack sometime now between Election Day, that can totally tip things. And I want to be careful here. I am not saying that anyone who votes for a particular candidate is bigoted or racist, but what I will say is when people are going with their emotions, and that's how we, attitude is an evaluative process. Part of it is belief, but part of it is emotion. And if we are under attack, I think the pool of people who would want an authoritarian candidate, and there is a decent number who would want an authoritarian candidate, even if their policies are opaque or downright silly, will not matter if they have a non-professorial answer. One of the things that I said on the Melissa Harris Perry show, which made it that video never appeared on the web, was I said, President Obama has to explain his national security plan to the American public in a way that is understandable and organized so that we won't have a vacuum that can be led by folks who are exploiting fears. If we have something that takes place where people become more fearful, I think there will be a tolerance for intolerance, and that will be a scary circumstance. Also, if violence takes place within the political process and it is skewed a certain way, that can have an effect as well. The more fearful people are, the more they will tolerate measures or even divisions that go against what they normally would do in periods of calm introspection.
Thank you, Brian, and thank you, Sharon.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
And for audience members, if you could fill out your evaluation sheets on your way out and leave them at the front door. And please join us in the Board of Trustees room for a light reception. Thank you, Professor Levin, once again.